also. Philippians 1 verse 3. I thank my God for my whole remembrance of you, constantly in my every supplication, making the supplication for you all with joy, because of your fellowship with the gospel from the first day until now, having confidence of this very thing, that he who has begun in you a good work will complete it unto Jesus Christ's day. As it is righteous for me to think this as to you all, because ye have me in your hearts, and that both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the glad tidings, ye are all participators in my grace. For God is my witness how I long after you all in the bowels of Christ Jesus. And so after this thanksgiving, we start with his prayer in verse 9. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in full knowledge and all intelligence, that ye may judge of and approve the things that are more excellent, in order that you may be pure and without offense for Christ's day, being complete as regards the fruit of righteousness, which is by Jesus Christ, to God's glory and praise. And if you have time, I want to read later a few more verses from chapter 1. What I said yesterday, I just want to review that briefly. When you know Israel's history, Israel in Egypt, and then delivered from the bondage, they crossed through the Red Sea, and then they were in the wilderness, and they went through the wilderness to ultimately reach the promised land. And I compared the deliverance from Egypt with the epistle to the Romans, where we see how God, through Paul's ministry, explains what his purpose is to set souls free. And we have seen that we are delivered from this world, and yet we are kept in this world. For Israel, it was successive. Egypt, the wilderness, Canaan. For us, we have been drawn out of this world the moment we were saved, and then God has left us in this world. But then this world has become a wilderness for us as believers, and we have the experiences of the wilderness, and then we reach the promised land. Now, to just continue the comparison, Romans takes you out of bondage and puts you on new ground, delivered to be God's people. Then in Corinthians you find a people in this wilderness, and God gave instructions to Moses, and we see in Numbers especially how all was organized. In Leviticus we see more the emphasis on the service of God in connection with the sanctuary, but in Numbers you see the people in the wilderness, and that goes parallel with First Corinthians especially, and Second Corinthians you can include, of course. And Galatians is a different character. I want to go to Ephesians. Then in Ephesians, you are in the promised land. But before you get there, we see Moses on the top of Mount Nebo, and he was allowed by God to see the promised land. God showed him the promised land. Moses had failed, and because of his failure, because of disobedience, he was not allowed to enter the promised land. But then God showed him the promised land. And the promised land was really in his heart. Now that is Philippians. In Philippians, you are still this side of the Jordan. You are not in the promised land yet. But the promised land is in your heart. Just like Moses anticipated that. And he loved to see that land in his... It was in his heart. But then when you go to Colossians, you see how the people entered the promised land through crossing the Jordan. And we hope to see in Colossians chapter 2 how they were identified with the Jordan and then entered the promised land. This is what is taught in Colossians 2, how we are identified with Christ, who died, was buried, and rose again. And then through that identification we enter then the promised land. But then the promised land was taken, as you find in the book of Joshua, and that is really between Colossians and Ephesians. Ephesians sees us in the promised land, sees us as the promised land taken, but with the challenge to make these things our own. We've seen yesterday evening, we are blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenlies in Christ Jesus. But then God wants us to make this a reality for each one of us through faith, so that we put our foot every step on this ground of the promised land to make it our own. So Christ in the glory, we are identified with him. He is in the promised land, and through faith we are there now in Ephesians. We are in him there, seated in him. At the same time, we are on this earth. And there is a conflict going on, because this conflict is in the heavenlies. Satan doesn't want us to occupy these blessings. He doesn't want us to enter into these things. And so we'll see tomorrow, or tonight then, in Paul's first prayer in Ephesians 1, how he wants us to really know these blessings and enter into these blessings. And then in chapter 3, tomorrow afternoon, we hope to see how we enjoy these blessings, Christ dwelling in us. And then we see this wonderful relationship we have with Christ, who is now in heaven, who is in us through the Holy Spirit, and he dwells in us, makes his dwelling place in us. That is how we enjoy the promised land. And then in Ephesians 6, tomorrow afternoon at the end, we hope to see then that this implies a spiritual battle, because the enemy comes back. Even if we've taken all these possessions and we enjoy them, the enemy tries to rob them again from us. And so there is spiritual battle involved in this. We are not in heaven yet. We are in the heavenlies in Christ. But we have this spiritual battle, because all the forces of the enemy are against us taking possession of these things. So that's why I suggested Paul's prayer first in Philippians, that we have read this afternoon. And then in the second session we go to Colossians. And then tonight we hope to go to Ephesians 1. Before we go there, I just want to highlight a little bit the connection with this prayer and Paul's ministry. You remember how Paul was called, Saul of Tarsus was called in Acts 9. Actually, we have 7 different accounts of this event. Paul's salvation is a crucial event, and we see that what is written about Paul has many lessons for every believer today. In 1 Timothy 1, Paul explains that what happened to him is really like an object lesson for everyone. If the chief of sinners can be saved, it means everyone can be saved. And so in Acts 9, that's now my point to connect it with Paul's prayers. After he saw the Lord in the glory and he became blind, then the Lord Jesus, he showed in a vision to Ananias, the disciple there in Damascus, in Acts 9, verse 10, there was a certain disciple in Damascus by name Ananias. And the Lord said to him in a vision, Ananias, and he said, behold, here I am I, Lord. And the Lord said to him, rise up and go into the street which is called Straight, and seek in the house of Judas one by name Saul, he is of Tarsus, for behold, he is praying. Saul of Tarsus, as a religious man, he was used to all kinds of prayers, the prayer book and in the synagogue, but that's not what the Lord meant. Here there was a man praying. Here he was in his distress. His whole life collapsed. He was in great distress, and now he was praying. And what I suggest, from the moment of his salvation to the end of his ministry, 2 Timothy 4, where he says that all had forsaken him, but the Lord stood with him, he is marked by prayer. There at the very end, just before he was executed, he was marked by prayer. He introduced the Lord into every situation. And that is why we learn a lot from Paul's prayers. And those 3 prayers that are before us today highlight certain points. But Paul was really a man of prayer. How did he learn that? And how do we learn to be men and women of prayer? We learn it from the Lord. The Lord on this earth was marked by prayer. He was always dependent on God. In Luke's gospel, you find the Lord Jesus as a man of prayer. One night he prayed the whole night. He was always a man of prayer. When he was baptized, before he started his public ministry, we see that he was praying there, the Jordan River. And so the Lord was marked by prayer. And in the book of Acts, we see a people, the people of God, marked by prayer. And so Saul of Tarsus became a man of prayer. And this is how we know him as Paul, the Apostle Paul, a man of prayer. And the prayers that he has written, just a minute before we get there, when he had this wonderful ministry in the book of Acts, he was called in Acts 13. Before that he was, I skipped some phases. In Acts 9 we see, when he was called by the Lord, he started to preach right away in the synagogue. He taught two things, that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, and he taught that Jesus is the Son of God. And those things the Jews always rejected. You can read it in the Gospels, and especially in John's Gospel. They rejected that the Lord Jesus is the Son of God. When he claimed to be the Son of God, they would try to stone him to death. When he would confess that he is the Christ, they didn't accept that either. They denied that he was the Christ. And so they want to get rid of him, and they executed him, the cross of Christ, when the time had come. But now my point is, in connection with Paul's ministry, he brought out those two points that the Jews rejected. And so he continued then. He had to flee. When he went back to Jerusalem, he was received by the believers through Barnabas, but then his life was in danger when he started to preach, and then he had to flee to Tarsus. And then after many years, we don't know exactly how many years, when Barnabas went out to Antioch, because in the meantime, the gospel proceeded. That is very interesting to see in the book of Acts how there was progress after progress, despite all the attacks of the enemy, despite all the failures, there was progress. And so the gospel came to Antioch in Syria, that is now part of present-day Turkey. And there, in Antioch, there was a wonderful group of Christians, that is the first, what we call, Gentile assembly. And then Barnabas went out to see for himself, sent by the apostles in Jerusalem, what was going on. And when Barnabas was there, he was encouraged, seeing the grace of God. And he preached there, he taught there, he evangelized there with the others. And then he thought, you know what, I have to find Saul of Tarsus. Because Barnabas introduced Saul of Tarsus in Jerusalem after Saul was saved. And then he had to flee. And now Barnabas went to look after Saul of Tarsus and brought him to Antioch. And then they both served in Antioch for a whole year. And then we see in Acts 13 that the Lord, through the Holy Spirit spoke through those five teachers, but in fact to the whole assembly in Antioch, and they were ready to go. So they were called by the Holy Spirit, and they were sent by the Holy Spirit, but the assembly there was in hearty fellowship with this whole exercise. And so then in Acts 13 and 14, you have the first missionary journey, and then there was tremendous opposition. In the epistle to the Galatians, you see how strong this opposition was. But Paul maintained the truth of God. That's why we have read in Philippians that he was set for the defense and the confirmation of the glad tidings. That is what happened in the book of Acts already very early. And then when Paul and Barnabas came back after his first journey, then we find how the enemy succeeded to penetrate inside the assembly, and there were these Judaizers, and that caused a great problem. And so they sent a delegation, Paul and Barnabas with others, to Jerusalem to settle that matter. And that was God's wisdom, because God wanted the unity to be kept. And so the enemy was defeated there, and then Paul started his second missionary journey, this time with Silas. And then Timothy joined in Acts 16, and then after a while also Luke joined. And so together they were led then to go to Philippi in Macedonia, in Europe. And there we have Lydia, the first convert under Paul's ministry. There were other converts in Europe already before that time, because very early a church started in Rome, not through the apostles, but through others who had been in Jerusalem in Acts 2, and they had seen there how the Holy Spirit came down. They had listened to Peter's ministry, and then they went back, and then a church started in Rome. So there were believers in Rome even before Paul went to Philippi on this second journey. And so he continued that second journey. It was a number of years. You find in chapter 16 and 17 and 18. And then at the end of Acts 18, Paul went to Ephesus, and they wanted him to stay there, but he said, no, I'm on my way to Jerusalem. He went up to Jerusalem, then he went back to Antioch, and then from Antioch he started the third journey. It's interesting, not from Jerusalem, but from Antioch. But he had gone up again from Jerusalem, and that is why he says in Romans 15 that his ministry was from Jerusalem up to Scythia, that is in northern Macedonia, Albania, around that area, Yugoslavia. And so then he went back to Macedonia, he went back to Greece, he wrote a letter to the Romans when he was there in Corinth. And then he went back from there to Jerusalem, and so then he finished his third journey. And then he was taken captive in Jerusalem. That's a long story, I cannot go into the details, but that shows how this ministry was under attack. After the first journey, during the second journey, and then especially at the end of the third journey, his ministry was under great attack. And in Romans 15, you see how he asked for prayers when he wrote Romans 15. He needed prayers to be kept. The Lord allowed that he was taken captive there in Jerusalem. Then he was for 2 years at least in Caesarea, and then after a while they sent him to Rome, and then from Rome, where he was as a prisoner of Rome, and that was for his protection. The Lord used that to protect Paul. He would have been killed by the Jews on many occasions, but the Lord sent him to Rome. And now my point is, now we come to Philippians, my point is now this: as a prisoner of Rome, God used that time for Paul that he could write those wonderful epistles. And I just want to mention that to you. Sorry that we have to go back to Acts one more time. In Acts 20, Paul summarized his ministry. And so what we have in his verbal ministry at that time, he had written only Galatians and 1st and 2nd Thessalonians so far. Then he wrote Romans, as I mentioned, at the end of his third missionary journey. But he did not write Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Those epistles were written during this captivity in Rome, when he was a prisoner of Rome. But before he got there, before he went back to Jerusalem at the end of his third journey, he says in Acts 20 what his ministry was all about. He would preach to the people, he would testify both to Jews and Greeks in verse 21, repentance towards God. So repentance means a change of mind and a change of heart, turning back to God, but also faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. At the same time, that repentance is marked by the fact that they put their trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. The second part of Paul's ministry is in verse 24, that he, at the end of verse 24, he had now come to the finish of that course, as he explains to the elders in Ephesus, and his ministry was received of the Lord Jesus, and it implied that he would testify the glad tidings of the grace of God. That was done by Paul, and that still continues today, the ministry of the glad tidings, the gospel of the glad tidings, the grace of God. That is what characterized our day. That is the gospel of the blessed God, the blessed God. It's the gospel of Christ, it's the gospel of God, it's the gospel of the blessed God, and here it is, the gospel of the grace of God. And then he had another part in his ministry, and that was preaching the kingdom of God in verse 25. That is not the kingdom as we will know it in the millennium. That's not the kingdom as it was announced by John the Baptist. This is the kingdom that he preached in the days that the king is rejected. You find it in Matthew 13, where the Lord gave those parables of the kingdom, and then we see that the king was rejected and he handed over the responsibility to his disciples, and the disciples would fail. That is what the Lord explains in Matthew 13. But my point is now this. This is the kingdom that is preached. While the king is rejected, while the king is absent, his interests are now maintained by his disciples. And so the disciples, the believers, need to be very much familiar with this kingdom of God. The Lord Jesus, after his resurrection, he talked for 40 days with the disciples about the kingdom of God. So that must be an important theme. In the book of Acts, you have 8 references to the kingdom of God. It is a very prominent theme. And so this is part of Paul's ministry. And then when you come to the climax of his ministry, and we saw that yesterday evening in Ephesians 1, then you come to the full counsel of God, verse 27, announcing to you all the counsel of God. And that goes together also with the assembly of God, which you find in verse 28. Wonderful things were committed to Paul, but it was all verbal. That was not in writing yet, except for the epistles that I mentioned. But in Thessalonians and also in Galatians and even in Romans, he did not go into the details that we find in Ephesians, Colossians and Philippians. So much more could be said about that, but now we finally turn back to Philippians, and we see there then how Paul was set for the defense and the confirmation of the glad tidings. That was his ministry all the way. But now he was there in prison in Rome. And there he was still for the defense of the glad tidings. We find 6 defenses in the book of Acts. And then we find 2 more later here, while he was in the first captivity in Rome. That's the 7th apology, the 7th defense. Paul was defending the gospel here while he was there in Rome in the prison. And the last defense was in 2 Timothy 4. When all had forsaken him, Luke was still with him. Then he was just before his death, that's about 5 years after this first captivity in Rome, he had his last defense. You can read it in 2 Timothy 4. And the Lord sustained him. So that is why I said earlier, Paul was a man of prayer. In all this ministry, in the defense of the gospel, he was a man of prayer. And the Lord helped him. Till the time had come that the Lord wanted him to go home. But that time had not come yet in Philippians. He speaks about that in Philippians, that to be with Christ is far better. But he says, it's more needful for you that I stay here. And so we are happy that God gave him then this opportunity to write this epistle to the Philippians. In this prison epistle, in these prison epistles, we find a height, we find a wonderful level of this ministry that Paul had obtained. He had communicated that verbally by word of mouth earlier, as we have seen in the book of Acts. But now God allowed this prison, the time in prison there, so that he would write it down, led by the Holy Spirit. And that is why we have it. If Paul would only have gotten around and preached the gospel with great success as he did, we would not have this. And so God in his wisdom allowed this to happen, that this difficult time for Paul there in prison was used by God to magnify the Lord Jesus and to write for us these wonderful things that we enjoy even today. And so in these first verses that we have read, he starts with thanking God. That's a wonderful point to start with. Prayers start with thanking God. And then and that's very practical, we often are so preoccupied with our needs that we forget to thank God. There's always reason to thank God, always. And so then he thinks about the believers, and he mentioned that he was always thinking of them with joy. It's important because yesterday after the meeting we had a discussion with a brother, and we mentioned the importance of joy. Here again it is. Philippians is the epistle of joy, you know it, sacrifices of joy. It is, joy is the theme of this epistle, but it was written by a man in prison. So how could he speak about joy? Because his eyes were fixed on the Lord. That is how he could speak about joy. That is how from the prison cell he could encourage others. And that is how we today, who are not in prison in that sense, we are encouraged by this epistle. And so Paul recommended the Philippians because of their fellowship with the gospel. They had a heart for the gospel. How that is important for us too, to have a heart for the gospel and to really have fellowship with the gospel. This is God's prime, not prime interest, but this is God. You cannot have the ministry of the assembly without the gospel. The two go together. You have to have the gospel before you have the ministry of the assembly, as we see in Colossians. But here we have then how Paul was recommending the believers in Philippi because of their involvement in the gospel. Paul was going on, even though he was there in prison, the gospel went on and he wanted to have it go on and he wanted the believers to go on. And today he wants us to go on. And so he had the confidence that what God had started, and that's another word of encouragement for all of us, what God had started in you and me, the moment we were saved, God started the work. And that work will be completed. Now in Ephesians we see that we are complete. In Colossians we see that we are complete in Christ. But here we are in Philippians, at the end of the wilderness. And so there it has not been completed yet. But it is going to be completed, and that will be shown in the day of Jesus Christ. It will be complete. That good work will be complete, and the Lord will show it off. The day when he will appear to this world with us. First he comes for the rapture. And then he comes back with us. And then this work that is complete by that time will be shown off to the world. And then Paul says in verse 7, it is righteous for me to think this as to you all because you have me in your hearts. So there was a wonderful fellowship between Paul and the believers there in Philippi. If you read the whole epistle, and especially the second epistle, you see how close the links were between the Philippians and Paul. And that is why he could say here already that both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the glad tidings, ye are all participants in my grace. So I cannot go into much detail now because of the time, but you get the gist of this. There's a wonderful fellowship between the Philippians and Paul, although he was there in prison. And then he says, God is my witness, how I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus, of Christ Jesus. That means Paul was thinking of the believers, and with this tender, the tender feelings, the same tender feelings that the Lord Jesus has, Christ Jesus, the anointed one in the glory, he has tender feelings towards all of us. Bowels means tender feelings. And those tender feelings, Paul had the same tender feelings towards the believers. So Paul was in tune with Christ Jesus himself, practically. The same feelings that Christ Jesus has towards the believers, Paul had. And so he confirms that God is his witness, how he longed after the believers. So what a wonderful relationship of love existed there between the believers and Paul, and in fellowship with God, in fellowship with Christ Jesus. And then he starts his prayer in verse 9. And I just want to highlight 7 points in this prayer from verse 9 to 11. Now, if you see the condition of these believers, you would say, 100%, excellent. Yes, true. But there is always room for improvement. And what we see in verse 9, this I pray, that your love may abound yet more. Now, you would say that is impossible. But that's why I said there is always room for improvement. If you say, you know, we have reached it, we have done everything, we are okay, that's the beginning of backsliding. There is always room for improvement. Paul says it in Philippians 3, not that I have reached it yet, but I stretched myself out. So he looked forward to reach that goal. He was not in the promised land yet. He was there like Moses on Mount Nebo, but he was reaching out. And he stretched himself out. And so that is why we also need this prayer, that our love may abound yet more and more. We have not reached the summit yet. And it is in connection with this full knowledge. So we have emphasis on love first. God starts often with light. But here is love first, because love draws us to Him. And then we find light. That is in connection with the full knowledge and intelligence. There you have God is light. Yesterday evening we considered in Ephesians 1 that we are now children of God. We have received a divine nature. And so God is light, God is love, and as His children, we are children to represent the God who is light, the God who is love. And so in connection with that, Paul's prayer is this, that this love may even abound more and more in full knowledge, but also in all intelligence. So the knowledge and the intelligence go together with the light. You can't separate them. They always go together. Love and light and love go together. And then the third point is that ye may judge of and approve. That's one word in the Greek, in the King James. I'll just check it, how it is written there. It's, I think, Philippians 1, verse 10, 11. That you may approve things that are excellent. So, but it implies the thought of having them pass the test. The word that's used there is to have things pass the test. And that is why the Darby version says judge and approve. So the idea is there, judge, you want to make it pass the test, and then approve, it has passed the test. And this is what a quality that God wants to develop in you and me. That as His children, love and light, that we will have the capacity to judge and approve, that we have the capacity to evaluate things, that we have the capacity to measure things. And that is spiritual maturity. Paul wanted the believers to be mature. Paul was not there in Philippi anymore, but he wanted the believers to go on their own wings, as it were, to stand on their own feet and to walk in true dependence upon the Lord. And that is what he wants for you and me also. The Lord wants us to have the ability to judge things. Now, the word judge has a negative connotation in our mind, but it really means to have to evaluate things and to accept what God accepts, to reject what God rejects, and then to stick to what is excellent, what is more excellent. So you have to make a choice. That implies the idea that you are able to make the right choice. And that is why I said this implies maturity. A little child, a baby or a little child cannot make the right choices yet. It has to learn certain things. And so as believers, we have to be taught, we have to learn, we have to grow spiritually and reach that maturity. Hebrews 5:14 speaks about that discernment that you receive when you become mature. Then you are able to discern what to accept, what to reject. And then the fourth point is pure. In order that you may be pure, the word literally means tested by sunlight, so that you are able to be really in tune with the high standard, God's light, the sun. And so Paul says here, in order that you may be pure. So that is a capacity that means you are in tune with God. You are really in harmony with God, and there is no nothing fake. You remember the Pharisees, they were very religious, but it was an outward form. It was also inward, leaven, but it was something that is abhorrible in God's eye. It was a facade. There was no reality. Here you have just the opposite. What God wants is, He wants us to be pure. And the light reveals it if everything is okay and not covered over, not plastered over, not real. He wants us to be real. With the Pharisees, there was a lack of reality, but God wants us to be real. And that is the idea of pure. The fifth point is without offense for Christ's day. So again, Christ's day, what will be before us when the Lord Jesus will appear in glory, when we will be with Him, the way we will be then, He wants us to be now already. So Paul was always looking forward to that manifestation, and he says, you know what? I want to be now already the way the Lord wants me to be when he comes back in the future. And then you are really in tune with God. If you see yourself in God's light, you judge what is not right, you accept what is approved by God, and you strive after that, then you will be without offense. You will not cause a stumbling block for anybody. Without offense means without stumbling block. The Pharisees, they became a stumbling block because they pretended to be something, but they were not. If we pretend to be something, but we are not what we say we are a stumbling block. It's very solemn. And so this is pure and without offense for Christ's day. That is how Paul wants us to be. So this reality, and then you are not a stumbling block. That doesn't mean that what you say is always without causing any offense. The gospel in itself is an offense. Paul explains it in 1 Corinthians 1. Today many people want to eliminate all the offense that is connected to the gospel. They are wrong because they are man-centered. They want to please man. Paul says in Galatians 1, if I want to please man, I'm an enemy of God. So the message will always cause offense because the flesh and human thinking doesn't buy it, doesn't like it. That's not the point here. The point here is that you are what you say. If you are not what you say, you are a stumbling block. That's the point here. So Paul wants this reality so that the message is in harmony with our conduct. That our conduct is in harmony with the message. That is what he wants. And then you are without stumbling towards others, without offense towards others. Then the sixth point is complete. In the King James it says being filled. That's the literal rendering. And that should be good. But the idea of complete is that we would be completely controlled by Christ. That the fruit of righteousness is seen in us. So this sixth point is that what I said earlier, that is purity, that is not causing any offense, results then in bearing fruit. And that is the fruit of righteousness. It's a practical righteousness. If we follow these steps that we saw earlier, we will produce fruit. God is looking for fruit. The Pharisees didn't have fruit. There was a lot of outward appearance. It was like the tree that the Lord cursed that was covered with the fig tree covered with leaves, but there was no fruit. God doesn't want that. He wants fruit. He wants reality. And that is the fruit that we find here, the fruit of righteousness. That is practical righteousness. You know how our wedding garment will be when the Lord Jesus will have his wedding day and we will be the bride at his side? The garment is called the righteous acts of the saints. That is what we find here, this practical righteousness. And that is seen as a fruit. It's the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22. There you have this fruit of righteousness. James speaks about this fruit of righteousness. It's connected with the wisdom from above. And when we follow the wisdom from above, then this fruit will be produced also in our lives. And it is my seventh point, by Jesus Christ. It's not because of our own efforts. Today, you know, I want to be just like Christ wants, and then he can approve me. It's not my effort. That's why we also need to pray, just like Paul. It's not based on our efforts. Yes, the desire of faith needs to be there, but it's not based on our efforts. It is by Christ's doing. The Lord Jesus Christ, the one who was here on this earth, always pleasing God. He wants to work now in us. He's now in the glory. And he wants to work in us so that this fruit of righteousness may be there to the glory of God. You can mention that as an eighth point. You can also tie it in with the seventh point. The fruit is by Jesus Christ. The result is to God's glory and praise. And I'd like to connect that with the end of this chapter. Paul was in great exercise for the believers, and he wanted Christ to be seen in the believers. And so at the end, you can tie that really with this prayer. He sums it up. He says in verse 27, only conduct yourselves worthy of the glad tidings of Christ, of the Christ. So here it's the glad tidings of the Christ. I said earlier, it's the glad tidings of God, it's the glad tidings of the blessed God, it's the glad tidings of Jesus Christ, here the glad tidings of Christ. In order that whether coming and seeing you or absent, I may hear of what concerns you, that you stand firm. So Paul's prayer continues here. Here expresses what he desired for them, what he prayed for them, the right conduct worthy of the gospel, then also that they would stand firm, the stability, we talked about maturity, here you have the stability that goes together with the maturity in one spirit. So here he emphasizes very much the practical unity of the believers, one spirit, one soul, laboring together, that's the third point, in the same conflict with the faith of the glad tidings, not frightened, verse 28, fourth point. And then in verse 29, not only believing on him, putting your trust in him, that is what we need to do every moment, but it implies also suffering for him. That's the sixth point. And then it's summed up in the seventh point, the same conflict which ye have seen in me and now hear of me. Paul there in Rome was in agony. The word conflict means agony. It was a battle on life or death. That is the situation for many believers today. They're involved in a battle, life or death. And that is also for us. We have to realize that in principle, it's true for us too, that we are involved in a conflict on life or death. And we can follow Paul's example in this. Trust in the Lord. We suffer because of this conflict, but then we will go on according to the example that Paul has left. So that is a very short introduction on this first prayer, and we have a break now, and then we continue with the second prayer in Colossians 1. So perhaps we can close with this.